Hello everyone, welcome to the daily newspaper analysis of the Shankar Ace Academy, brought to you by the Civil Speedia team. Let us see the list of articles for today. So before that, there is just a small announcement to be made. The pre-storming session for the UPSC prelim test series of 2025 is starting from 21st of November. So interested candidates can apply for the admission process. And also Shankar Ace Academy is bringing in the initiative of Chakra, where we provide a detailed course on test series of current affairs, online and offline detailed discussion. So interested candidates are welcome to join the course. Now let us get into the topics for discussion. The first article discusses about the allegations on the Adani group, where they are accused of bribery and corruption. The next article talks about the effects of the Typhoon Yagi in Myanmar. The third article talks about the megalithic structures of India, where a recent discovery has been made in Kerala. And finally, the last article talks about the cyclone called Bomb Cyclone, which hit the US recently. So without any much further delay, let's get into the article's discussion. Let us move into the news article. There has been a powerful storm which has hit the northwest of the US, and due to its intensification with heavy rainfall and strong winds, it has been named as Bomb Cyclone. And this storm is one of the most powerful storm for the decade alone. So let us move on to its formation, its types. So a storm is nothing but having a very significant atmospheric disturbances which are characterized by extreme weather conditions such as heavy rainfall, heavy wind, thunderstorm, hailstorm, and so on. So due to the atmospheric instability and a high amount of and energy fluctuations, storm can vary in different intensification, which can lead to strong winds and heavy precipitation. So let us see what are the types of storm. First would be a cyclone. A cyclone would be forming in the warm ocean areas. It is a large rotating storm with heavy rainfall and heavy winds. So this kind of storm is known as cyclone in the Indian Ocean, and hurricane in the Atlantic Ocean, and typhoon in the Pacific Ocean. And next is the type 2, which is the thunderstorm. It has characteristics of heavy rainfall, heavy winds, along with lightning and thunder. Next is a tornado. It is a small but violent storm. It has funnel-shaped cloud, where its intensification would be very devastating as it would be touching the ground. And next is the snowstorm, where there would be precipitation in the form of snow and hails. Next is hailstorm. Snowstorm can bring in blizzards and can increase the low visibility around the neighborhood. So looking into the hailstorm, here there would be large big sizes of ice balls which can damage the surroundings such as the building, crops, and so on. Next is the sandstorm or dust storm, where there is, along with the heavy winds, there is heavy sand and debris, where of course it will be creating the problem of visibility, and also creates a problem of having in diseases. Next is ice storm with the freezing rain, where it coats everything with ice and it will be very slippery around the neighborhood. Next is the windstorm, where there will be strong wind with a little rain and a little precipitation, but the wind would be very strong and it can cause damage to trees as well as low buildings. Let us see the general conditions for the storm formation. First is having a condition of atmospheric instability, as the warmer from the ground and will be slowly lifting up to the colder in the atmosphere, and it creates a pressure for the formation of storm. Next is having the high humidity. So this warmer and as well as the colder will be having the moisture of the air, where there would be a high amount of water vapor, and it would form and it would lead to the formation of clouds, and it would, and through this formation it would be intensifying the heat or humidity, which would be intensify the storm. Next is having a lifting mechanisms, where conditions like fronts or any mountains or localized heating or convection can would be factors to lift up the moisture air for storm formation. Next is having a temperature contrast. There is a vast temperature difference, which is the warmer as well as the colder, where this would form the pressure. Storms typically form in the low pressure area, and as it rises, it cools down, as and there would be a cloud formation and it cools down, and then it would be having heavy rainfall, heavy storms along with heavy precipitation. So this is the picture for the formation of storm. Here of the warm air would be in the ground, and as it gets aloof, it would be combining with the cold air in the atmosphere, and there would be moisture content formation along with the formation of the humidity. And again, due to this huge difference of temperature, which is warm air and cold air, there would be cloud formation, and then there would be a storm along with the heavy wind. So I hope this topic is clear, and now let us move on to a prelims practice question. Consider the following: fronts, convection and humidity. Which of the above can influence the formation of storms? And definitely the answer would be all three. So moving on to the next news, regarding the megalithic culture of India, there has been a significant discovery in Kerala, Kasargod, where there have been found that there are 24 pair of rock and footprints and a human figure from the megalithic period. So in light of this article, let us see its features. So this is the discovery. So the location is Kanhirapol from Kasargod of Kerala, and they have found 24 pairs of rock cut footprints and a human figure from the megalithic period, which has its timeline of approximately 2000 years ago. So the technique here used here would be carvings made out of iron weapons, which also symbolizes the iron age. And these rock cut footprints are similar to other rocket footprints like Avalakipera from Udupi of Karnataka, and other northern Kerala sites such as Edukkal caves, and caves like rocket formation like Edukkalapattu. Here it symbolizes the meaning of souls and ancestral worship of the deceased people and other goddess worship. As the rocket formation also have human figurines in the direction of westward, where it signifies deceased souls. So let us see what is megalithics are. They are large stones structures where they are used for monuments or burials built from the Neolithic age to Iron Age. So their time period timeline would be 1500 to 500 BC, and the megalithics origin would be introduced through sea routes from places like Eurasia, Europe, where they are called as Cynthia cells, and even having its origin from the Dravidian. Some Indian tribes like Gonds, Garo and Nagas of India also follow the megalithic culture. Now let us see the types of megalithic. First type would be polylithic megalithics, where there would be multiple stones. So the first type would be dolmens, where it has the construction of stone chambers with capstones. So this would be the example. Next is there are stone piles. So this would be the example for cairns, where these stone piles would signify burial places or landmarks. Next form would be cromlechs, where they are also another type of prehistoric megalithic structures. And next would be cyst, where they are stone boxes for the burial. And the next type would be monolithic, where there is only usage of single stone. First is the menhirs, which would be a single stone, where it would be an upward monolithic structure, and this is the example. And next is the stone circles, where there would be single stone structures in a circle. So let us look into some notable megalithic sites in India. In south, Adichanallur from Tamil Nadu, and Brahmanagiri from Karnataka, and Serekala from Jharkhand, Deodhura from Uttarakhand, and also other from the central India. So in light of this article, let us see a prelims practice question. Which one of the following was the first excavated megalithic site in India? And the answer would be Adichanallur from Tamil Nadu. So moving on to the next article, this article discusses about the allegations on the Adani group for corruption and bribery. So let us see the Prevention of Corruption Act of 1988 and its provisions. So it is one of the principal anti-corruption law in India to prevent corruption practices in the public offices. So here they define corruption, which includes bribery, embezzlement and abuse of power. Next, it penalizes both the giver and the receiver when it comes to corruption. So, and next it brought the concept of corporate liability, where it helped to hold accountability of companies for bribes for the employees. Also, it mandates prior government sanctions when it comes to the prosecution of public officials. So there were few amendments in this act in 2018. It introduced more stricter punishments, which includes 3 to 7 years of imprisonment for corruption. It also criminalized the act of bribe giving, and it also protects honest officials and public servants from the undue harassment by requiring for prior approval for the investigation. Next would be Lokpal and Lokyukta's Act of 2013. Here the main objective would be establishing anti-corruption ombudsman, where Lokpal would be at the central level and Lokyukta's would be at the state level. Includes investigation for public servants, including the Prime Minister. So the key features would be, it covers all public servants, including the ministries, group A officers, Prime Minister, and so on. Lokpal also have jurisdictions over organizations which are receiving foreign contributions, which is about 10 lakhs, and they also provide protection for whistleblowers. Next is the Central Vigilance Commission Act of 2003. Here, this act objective would be to establish a Central Vigilance Commission as an apex body to combat the corruption in the government. The key features would be including, it oversees the vigilance administration of the central government organization. And the next key feature would be, it also investigates corruption cases received by the government or the public complaints. And next we would be seeing few international conventions regarding corruption. First would be the United Nations Convention Against Corruption, where India was ratified in 2011. It also promotes and encourages international cooperation when it comes to corruption. Next is the OECD Anti-Bribery Convention. India is not a member, but to combat the cross-border bribery, it aligns with their principle. So I hope this article is clear, and let us move on to a prelims practice question. Which of the following statements regarding the Central Vigilance Commission is correct? The CVC was established in 1964 based on the recommendations of Santhanam Committee. The commission is a statutory body established under the Central Vigilance Commission Act of 2003. The CVC can directly file cases in courts against the public servant. The tenure of the Central Vigilance Commissioner is 6 years. The right answer would be only 1 and 2. The tenure is not for 6 years, but it is for 4 years. Moving on to the last article. The humanitarian crisis in Myanmar has worsened due to natural disasters like Typhoon Yagi, where 3.4 million people have been displaced and almost 40% are children. So first, we need to know the basis of its geographical location and so on. So Myanmar, or called Burma, is located in the Southeast Asia. It acts as a bridge between the South and the Southeast Asia. So looking into their borders, they share borders with China in North and Northeast. And in the East and Southwest, they share their borders with Laos and Thailand. In West, they share their borders with Bangladesh and India. And in South, they share with the Bay of Bengal and Andaman Sea. So here, this is the map. We can see their border sharing through the South and Southeast. Now looking into their physiographic divisions, here they home to peaks like Cabo Razi, which is the highest peak in the Southeast Asia. Next, they have central lowlands, where it includes fertile plains which are drained by major rivers. Next, looking into the western ranges, it includes the Arakan Yoma, which separates Myanmar from the Bay of Bengal. And next is the eastern plateau, which extends into the Shan Plateau. Now looking into their major rivers, their drainage system includes Irrawaddy, which is the longest river which flows into the Andaman Sea, and they are very vital for irrigation, transportation and agriculture. Next is the Chindwin River, which is the tributary of the Irrawaddy. Next river is the Salween River, where it originates in Tibet and it flows into the Andaman Sea. Next is the Sitang and Mekong River, which are two key rivers which are important for water system as well as their key resources. So this is a map for the river system of Myanmar, and Irrawaddy flows into the Andaman Sea here. Now let us see the natural resources of Myanmar. First is the jade. So Myanmar is known for jade as being the world's largest producer, contributing almost 90% of the global supply. They import high quality jade from Pakhant, Kachin state, which is after China. Next, they are known for their rubies, owned by the Mogok Valley. They are known for their pigeon red color. Other gems also include sapphires, and they are found in the gold tin and tungsten are found in these places of Myanmar. Next is the natural gas. They have their major offshore fields in these places, and they are exported to China, Thailand and beyond. They are also known for their teak and hardwoods, where Myanmar is established as a global leader for these products. They bring in high quality teak from places like Shan from Myanmar, and their forest cover is almost 48% of the country, which is very, very crucial for biodiversity as well as carbon sequestration. So let us look into few India's humanitarian aid when it comes to Myanmar. In 2024 recently, we gave relief aid for the disaster of Typhoon Yagi. We brought in the emergency supplies like food, water, medicine and temporary shelters. We also brought in the deployment of the INS Gariel, and we also brought in the Operation Samudra Maitri for relief purposes. Next, we gave in the vaccination drive called the Project Maitri for COVID-19 for the country Myanmar. Next, looking into the cross-border projects, we brought in the development of cyclone shelters and resilient housing under disaster management programs. Projects like Kaladan Multimodal Transit Transport Project were introduced to improve the infrastructure and connectivity issues. India has almost provided 1.5 billion humanitarian assistance for the cyclone hit areas. And on a global level, India works with the ASEAN partners to provide a coordinated humanitarian support. Also, Myanmar is very crucial for India Act East policy and the other infrastructure project like the trilateral highway connecting India, Myanmar and Thailand. Also, issues like border management when it comes to Indo-Myanmar and countering issues like insurgency are their key focus. So, in light of this article, let us move on to a prelims practice question. The Mogok Valley in Myanmar is renowned for producing which of the following gemstones? And the answer would be C, rubies. Thank you so much for watching this video. Don't forget to give a like, comment and share. And to further not to miss any other content, subscribe to our channel. Thank you and have a great day.